Juan Manuel Fangio of Argentina. Fangio contested 51 Grands Prix from 1950 to 1958, winning a record 24 races, driving with the great European racing marks of Alfa Romeo, Mercedes, Ferrari and Maserati. The Maserati 250F Formula One car, a beautifully balanced, fine-handling car and a joy to drive right on the limit. At the French Grand Prix on the high-speed circuit at Reims, we reached nearly 180 miles an hour on the back straight in the 250F Maserati. Motor racing in Britain was creating a lot of interest in the 50s. Innovative car design was flourishing. The Formula One World Championship was experiencing new competition from Britain.
Slide a little too.
Yes, but not quite as much, you see. Then just as it starts to break away, straighten the car up like that, not normal correction, and at the same time put your foot hard on the accelerator, which then gets the car drifting like that.
John Cooper's innovative rear engine design revolutionized world championship competition. I won the 1958 Argentine Grand Prix in a Cooper. This was the first victory for a rear-engine Formula One car. The Cooper T51 was lightweight and a delight to drive. In 1960, Lotus had constructed a rear-engine Formula One car, the Lotus 18, seen here being pushed in the paddock by its designer, Colin Chapman. Graham Hill liked the look of my Lotus. My first race in the Lotus 18 was at the 1960 Monaco Grand Prix, which I won. In 1961, I drove the Lotus 18-21 and had victories in Monaco and in Germany at the mighty Nürburgring. The Nürburgring was a fantastic driver's circuit, 14.2 miles long, 178 corners, and over 1,000 feet in elevation. It really was a great challenge.
The Nürburgring. It is the most difficult, the most demanding, and the most dangerous. 375,000 people come to watch it. But look at it. This is the descent down to Adenau. Through blind left and right-handers, hedges and fir trees you see sometimes on the left are only the tops of the very tall ones. To the great carousel, aiming the car at the top of a pine tree because you couldn't see the entrance. the forest, it's very difficult. You're travelling at very high speeds, up to more than 170 miles an hour, the car leaping off the road in some occasions. Look at that. There it goes off the road as you're leading up to the little carousel. Again, you go into the concrete, very heavy in a driver's hand, jumping out of it and preparing to get it right for the main straight. You've got to come out of that carousel well. You're going into a right-hander. Then you go over another rise, as you go over that into another right-hander. And that right-hander leads you to a very long straight indeed, where for the first time you can breathe a little bit, you can relax your hands. The spectators love it.
One never really goes round there, I don't think, to the limit of the motor car. Going round, jumping from one bump to another, really, and just making what you can of it.
Yes.
Gear for paddock, off camber left hander, a bit of wide, put the power down in fourth gear, brake hard into third, up into second, down into second, in for Druid, hugging the curb all the way around, the flag, the power, back in, straight into fourth gear from second, because it's downhill, applying the power, going along the bottom behind the pits, down into third gear, long left hander, a tight, tightening corner. Car understeers a bit, flag the power. Accelerating along. The outside of a car braking hard. Fourth gear now, what used to be Hawthorns. Accelerating along at fourth gear, travel into third gear. Into third gear for this corner. Accelerating and into fourth gear down Deer's Leap. Into third gear again for a tight right-hander corner over the curb slightly. Accelerating hard, down into second gear. Opposite lock into third gear. Into fourth gear, going towards the bridge, braking hard. Into third gear.
Patrick Dupayet, Jody Scheckter, and Jackie Stewart, three drivers that have been very successful in Monaco. And here you have this six-wheeler Tyrrell with four wheels up front. You had quite a bit of rubber on the ground. Glamorous, challenging, a track that required concentration second to none.
Thank you.
l'hôtel de Paris qui se négocie en troisième et le droit du casino. Le circuit est très difficile parce qu'il demande beaucoup de changements de vitesse. Il n'y a pas de ligne droite pour se reposer, il n'y a aucun temps de répit. Le gauche le plus lent du circuit, avec le virage de la Rascasse, nous sommes ici au virage de l'ancienne gare. Virage du Portier en seconde. Le bord de mer et le fameux tunnel.
Pista Magica, the magic track, the tifosi, the Ferrari fanatical fans, the fabulous engine sounds, that's Monza. Jacques Lafitte. Ligier Matra. Sound of the Matra engine was just spectacular. It just sounded like power.
Thank you.
Long Beach. The fans just love getting up close. Patrick Depailler. On the back straight, we reach 190 miles an hour on closed public roads.
Senna starts a qualifying lap, pushing to the limits. Damon Hill is starting on pole position. Michael Schumacher is in second position. We're looking back from Damon Hill's Formula One Williams on the starting grid before the 53rd Monaco Grand Prix. Race is stopped after the first corner pile-up at Saint-Devot. Race restart. Spectacular Spa-Francorchamps circuit in the Ardennes Forest of Belgium. Mika Häkkinen of Finland competing for Formula One supremacy with Michael Schumacher at the 2000 Belgian Grand Prix. Monza, Italy, the world's fastest Grand Prix circuit. The Ascari chicane, where Schumacher approaches at about 210 miles per hour before braking. The 180 degree parabolica. The Formula One Ferrari reaches 230 miles per hour on the pit straight. The state-of-the-art Ferrari 2003. Michael Schumacher.
Giuseppe Farina of Italy, the first world champion in 1950.
Durissima sia per gli uomini che per le macchine. Per questo è anche una corsa molto incerta e quindi il pronostico è difficilissimo.
The Alfa Romeo 158, powered by the supercharged 1.5-litre straight-eight engine, produced an incredible 400-plus horsepower. Just take a look at the narrow rear tyres. The powerful Alfa's fuel consumption was a staggering 1.7 miles to the gallon, requiring two or even three stops in a Grand Prix. In those days, championship races were either a minimum of 3 hours or 500 kilometers. Alberto Ascari of Italy was world champion in 1952 and 53. In 1952, Ascari won all six Grand Prix with his Ferrari. This was cause for great celebrations by the Italians.
Oh,
Juan Manuel Fangio of Argentina, 5 times world champion. Captured by a special slow-motion camera at Rance, Fangio controls his Maserati 250F in a magnificent four-wheel drift at 150+. Of age, Fangio won his 5th world championship. Mike Hawthorn, the first British world champion in 1958. Jack Brabham of Australia, world champion in 1959, 1960 and 1966. Brabham built his own Formula One car in England, and in 1966, he became the first Formula One driver to win both the World Drivers' and Constructors' Championships. Jack won his last Grand Prix in 1970 at the age of 43. Phil Hill of the United States, world champion in 1961. Ferrari's first rear-engine Formula One car, the Sharknose. Graham Hill of Great Britain, world champion 1962 and 1968. Hill was also known as Mr. Monaco, winning the Monte Carlo Grand Prix 5 times. Graham Hill was the only driver to win the Formula One World Championship, the Indianapolis 500, and the Le Mans 24 Hours.
Jim Clark. He won 26 Grand Prix in a style with a smoothness that no other driver, perhaps has ever matched. A man of incredible skill, Jay Clark was something very special. John Surtees drove for Ferrari. Surtees is talking to Forgheri, one of the best engineers that motorsport has ever known. John Surtees also drove for Honda. They had known him from motorcycle racing. Denny Holm from New Zealand, flying at the notorious Nürburgring. Denny won the Nürburgring in 1967, the same year as he won the World Championship.
Well done, Dennis Holm. Well done, McAdams. One and two.
Jochen Rindt. He drove for Colin Chapman. He was fast and he was furious. Jochen won the Grand Prix of Monaco in 1970, winning the race on the very last corner of the very last lap. Spraying champagne, one of the first times I ever did it, at the French Grand Prix in Clermont-Ferrand.
Twice world champion Emerson Fittipaldi, very popular Brazilian. Here's Emerson Fittipaldi powering his Lotus through the carousel at the Nürburgring. Yeah. three times world champion Niki Lauda. World champion James Hunt.
And they got it right. I follow the sports cars. Good engine, Ted.
Very flamboyant race driver. The start of Japanese Grand Prix, torrential rain, incredible race. Lotus 79, fabulous race car of the era. The car that brought me the world championship. Jody Scheckter, world champion. Very aggressive. Scheckter had as great a car control as I've ever seen. Alan Jones, world champion. A very, very aggressive driver. Nelson Piquet. Keke Rosberg, the Flying Finn, world champion. Keke was another one of those drivers that loved to drift the car through the corners. Thank you. Alan Prost, four times world champion. They called him the professor. Very articulate, very precise, very technical driver. Ayrton Senna, another rare talents. Three times world champion Ayrton Senna. World champion Nigel Mansell. Another very, very aggressive driver, exciting to watch. Damon Hill, second generation world champion. World champion Jacques Villeneuve. Two times world champion Mika Hakkinen. Michael Schumacher, seven times world champion.